Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Baka, Baka, Baka podcast.
Baka!
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 Baka.
It's amazing how every time you open your mouth, you prove you're an idiot.
Welcome to Baka, Baka, Baka. This is our anime podcast that works like a book club where every 2 weeks we watch an anime and come together in this podcast to discuss it before turning the discussion over to you on the social media. Before we get started, let's introduce my co-host. We have the Pika to my Chew. Jeremy, how are you doing, man? What you been up to?
I'm doing really well. Honestly, haven't really been up to that much. I did get a chance to watch a little bit of Mushishi or Mushishi.
Yeah?
Always pronounce it wrong, yes. And I gotta say, I love the world. I love the world, and I love what the setting is for all of these strange mushy creatures. That is really cool. But it's a little bit too slice of life for me.
He hates your anime.
Yeah, I don't want to be super harsh on it.
No, it is slow.
It has a lot of awesome. It's so slow.
It is slow.
Yeah, and I don't do well with episodic stuff, so I haven't finished it.
Fair enough.
Okay, then we have my other host. Wait for it.
Oh man,
the Jiggly to my Puff.
Oh.
Jason, hey, so, man, what you been up to?
One of my favorite super melee characters. So actually, this week I am not offended.
Then I have done poorly.
You need to try again.
Just defending an anime that I really like.
Fair enough.
This one?
That's absolutely.
Okay.
And I am Troy. I will be hanging out with these two nerds tonight. And I have been falling in love with food wars over and over and realizing my cooking is nowhere near adequate. That anime, I love so much. I love it.
It's just the fan service, right? That's what you like. All the old men.
What's worse, that I get more excited by the food than the boobies?
I think what you need to be concerned about is if your cooking elicits responses like that, yeah. Then I think you need to reevaluate your life.
And your
I die a little inside when everyone's clothes stay on and I feed them dinner.
Fair enough.
From anime.
All right, but the anime we are talking about in this podcast is Kabaneri of the Iron Fortress. This is made by Studio Wit. They created Attack on Titan. It was directed by Tetsuro Araki. He did High School of the Dead, Attack on Titan, and Death Note. And the writer is Ichiro Okochi of Code Geass fame. So a lot of high caliber animes in the pedigree of this anime. And Jeremy, why don't we start with you? What'd you think?
Honestly, I would not recommend this to anyone. I would say in some cases, if you have a good imagination, go ahead and watch the first 6-7 episodes. But that would be it for me.
Boo.
It just did not, it so many layers got peeled away. There was nothing left for me at the end.
Jason, hit us up with your rebuttal.
For the first thing I want to say, how dare you? second, I think they mixed up the tropes in a way that was refreshing and interesting to storytelling. And actually, I cannot wait for the second season because I do have questions that I hope they either address or at least allude to.
Do we have any confirmation of a second season? I couldn't find out.
None whatsoever. But okay. Even if it did end here, I'm actually happy with where it went. Because it should... So I'll get into it a lot more later, but it should have ended a bit better here at the end because how much higher can you go than where it went? But okay. Anyways.
I'm somewhere in the middle of you guys. I completely disagree with Jeremy because I enjoyed the second
That's
half
the
more.
Middle.
But I didn't hate this anime. I enjoyed my time with it, but I don't also think it was a good anime. So I that's where my middle ground is for this.
Pick a side.
I'm the United Nations of this podcast, and I will treat everything fairly
neutral.
So let's get started with digging into this. Guys, this anime is about steampunk samurais that ride trains and fight iron-hearted zombies.
That sounds cool.
Yeah, that's really great.
Cool. Yeah.
So my expectations for this when I saw just the art was World War Z with Snowpiercer.
Yep.
Yep. I wanted Battlestar Galactica meets The Walking Dead, but I got Diet Attack on Titan.
I didn't have any real expectations for it. I just knew that it was from the Attack on Titan people and it was about zombies. I like steampunk, so I thought it's got to be good. They've got to be able to tell a good story here. So that was it for expectations for me.
So this anime starts with a huge action scene where a train is rolling through and zombies are attacking it. And this is where we kind of get introduced to these zombies, which are called Kabane. Am I saying that right?
No. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
Why? Why? This is why you get Jigglypuff. What did you guys think of the... I'm going to treat them like a character themselves, because usually zombies are. What did you think of the Kabane?
I love the Kabane, and I love what they did with them, but they left them alone. They didn't keep going with them by about episode 6 or 7. So are we ready for spoilers, or should I just not mention what they did?
Oh, yeah, we do. So we're getting into this. Let's drop the major spoiler warning, which we always almost miss. Guys, if you haven't seen this, we are talking about everything that happens in it. So you should go back and watch it. Unless you don't care, then we'll just tell you everything. We're obviously going to go through the whole thing, so if it's something that could be brought up better later, that's fine, but it doesn't matter if you drop a spoiler now.
Okay. The spoiler is just that they can learn. And to me, that was really cool because that opened up a whole world of possibilities when you combine it with their community awareness. Those two things made the zombies fascinating, the Kabane fascinating to me.
How about you, Jason?
I liked them a lot. The one thing I was a bit disappointed with was past the Iron Heart, there wasn't much about them that was different than other zombie storytelling, if you will. But it was interesting that they had more ability than normal shamblers, right? They could pick up swords. They did have the community awareness, and most zombie genres have that, right? One smells something and they all start running.
Oh, I have to say that that's different than what I meant. What I meant is, like, after you kill one, suddenly they all get aggressive. That was the community awareness I meant. Where it was like, if you didn't kill them, they shamble slowly towards you. But as soon as you kill one, they're like, you killed one of us, you die now. And they start charging.
I didn't get that.
That was different to me.
I saw quite a few scenes where, yeah, they would shamble at each other for like dramatic effect. But even if there wasn't any violence from the living, they would still charge. At least that's what I saw. A few times.
This anime is about the Kabaneri, the human Kabane hybrids. The Kabaneri can sense Kabane. Guys, this anime, this is a vocab test waiting to happen.
You could just call the Kabaneri vampires. I mean, they're practically that.
So what I mean, though, is the Kabaneri can sense when these zombies are around. Mm. So there's no reason to think they can't sense each other. So I almost see them as drawing towards each other. That's why they're in such big groups. And if one dies, they can actually almost psychically sense that. We get a sense of there's some kind of psychicness to this virus.
Yeah, you're right. I didn't catch that. You're right.
So we're going to keep going. The other person we meet in this sequence is a young man who is building a weapon that can kill these Kabane because they have hearts made of iron and they cannot be pierced by regular weapons. And this is Ikoma, our main protagonist.
Okay, I need to interrupt you for a sec. Their hearts aren't made of iron. They have an iron cage around the heart.
Okay.
I'm a jerk.
No, you are absolutely correct, and I just absolutely don't care. So.
Fair enough.
Ikoma, what'd you guys think of the Shaggy inventing? What'd you guys think of Ikoma?
For me, I loved him and hated him. I think the writers did an okay job trying to express this kid in an emotional fragile state that was trying to solidify his place in the world. The problem was the first 7 or 8 episodes, his emotions are so all over the road that it's very tough to identify with him. So you want him to be a hero, and in some cases he's heroically idiotic, and in other cases he's a wimp. And so there's a lot of moments where you're just like, you're rooting for him. And unfortunately they used it as a plot device. His wimpiness when they needed him to be wimpy, and his heroicness when they needed him to be heroic. And I felt that was a little lazy.
You know, you pretty much took the words out of my mouth. I feel exactly the same way about Ikoma. It almost seemed to me that they didn't want to make a show about him that much. It was almost like they wanted to make a show about everybody else because they kept slapping him out of the way. They're putting him in a prison here. They're putting him in a prison inside of the train later. They're knocking him out. They're throwing him overboard. They're doing all these things to keep him out of the center of the camera until they need him for some pivotal moment. It almost felt like they didn't necessarily like the character, or they were trying to give him so many obstacles so that you would feel that this character was overcoming so many difficulties. But then they present him with those situations with the crazy zombies that have learned, and he's super overpowered. So you have that. Yeah, he's a character that I loved his personality in the beginning, but as it went on, I kept seeing that complete dichotomy there. And in the end, he's just sort of I'm so determined things are going to go my way. I'll make them be that way no matter what stands in my way. And that's not a character to me. It's ridiculous.
For the most part, I couldn't stand him. I'm a person who I'm the emotional guy on the podcast, right? And I couldn't get emotionally attached to this character. Decisions he made didn't make any sense. Reactions to things didn't make any sense. You know, things would go wrong and he seemed to just be like, meh, you know? but he did get a little bit of a redemption later for me when the antagonist joined because of the, what's the opposite of parallel? the way their personalities were perpendicular to each other. We'll get into that. I want to get into that at the when we get to the antagonist. So in this episode, we start off, we find out humans live behind walls in train stations, right? Because trains are the only way to get around. They live behind walls. The anime starts off with a train actually crashing into the town where Ikoma lives, releasing the Kabane into it. He gets to test his weapon. It works, but he gets bitten, and he has to strangle himself using machinery in a very, very intense scene. You know,
It was my favorite scene, I think, out of the anime, because right away you see this just dire situation. And I think this is where Ikoma shined for me, is that when he was in those dire situations, he did pull through in a rock'em sock'em fighting with your bare teeth kind of way. Unfortunately, he didn't hold up for all the reasons we just mentioned. But what was great about it is it showed that this virus could be fought against, but you didn't. Unfortunately, the anime doesn't go into how.
Right.
And also it doesn't present itself in that particular situation either, but you're right. It was very intense where he's fighting for his life and he barely comes away with it.
This was actually kind of cool because in this scene, Tanya says, she's sitting there, she goes, that was really hot. Like the masculinity was just pouring off of him. That was wow. You know, he's shooting himself with the river gun. And I'm like, that was really cool, but masculine? Okay, I guess I can kind of see it. All right. All right. Yeah. So that's her favorite scene too.
Shout out to Tanya. Shout out to Tanya. If she kills you, you totally deserve it right now.
No, she told me it's okay. She said I could say it.
Fair enough. you know, he has this great moment where he strangles himself. But like right before that, he's like, my gun works. And I'm like, oh, kid, I can't. The whole entire village is burning. Maybe not cheering so much.
When he's strangling himself, right? This whole premise of how this virus works, it doesn't work because what they're saying.
You can't hold on to science.
Oh, come on.
In this anime.
Scientists to do this. So that was a huge, for me, that was a really big problem. As soon as they were like, oh, he has to wear this choker to keep the virus from reaching his brain. But she pulls a ribbon off every time, which lets the virus reach her brain. But oh no, it just retracts when she puts the ribbon back on as long as she gets blood, right? Come on.
Or sleeps.
That doesn't function. Or sleeps, right? So that the premise for me was broken at that point because I was like, your logic doesn't work.
So the person Jeremy is actually referring to is Mume, who we do kind of meet in the first episode, but also is in the second episode where she gets her big fight scene of taking the nobles and a lot of the survivors through the town to the train. And she's not really guiding them, but she's killing everything in her way. And we find out that she's just this awesome warrior doing flips and firing her double shotguns. And so, guys, thoughts on Mume?
She was my favorite character because she was that tropey heroine, but done in an interesting way. And also the Achilles heel for her was really interesting. So I think probably now is a good time to start talking a bit more about the Kabaneri, which we alluded to with Ikoma. Ikoma gets bit, but he's able to stop the virus from getting to his brain. These are Kabane, but they haven't lost their humanity. And due to this, they are endowed with superhuman abilities. And so, like Troy was just saying, Mume was able to do like flips. She was strong enough to take metal and pierce it through the Kabane's heart cages. And also her shots are amazing. Mm-hmm. So, but she is also Kabaneri. So she's got the heart cage. She's got the virus, but she's held on to her humanity.
I think the introduction to her ability to fight was one of my favorite scenes as well, because she's just walking down this corridor, a zombie comes and she just out of nowhere just kicks him and her foot gets stuck because of the blade on the bottom of her shoe hitting the wood. That was awesome. That was great. But there's a scene near the in the last few episodes where one of the guys yells, you know, his head is still human, shoot him in the head. And so specifically, it's not just that they're like holding on to their human values, but supposedly their head is actually still the human part. And so that to me is very interesting about Kabaneri, because it presents this weakness. It's like headshot's going to kill them no matter what, because they're still human there.
Yeah, I wondered that the whole anime, if that was a weakness. And they do confirm that, definitely
is shot to the head.
So Mume, who I did not recognize when she changed to her battle gear.
Yeah,
I was like, who's this new character? Yeah. Oh, it's her. Okay, never mind. So she gets everyone to the train. Ikoma gets to the train. Everyone gets on the train. And the daughter of the head of this station is now in charge. And she has the master control key, which ends up being very important later, right? So she's the only one who can turn on this train, and she's kind of the de facto leader of the survivors on board this train that is the focus of our anime. What did you guys think of Ayame?
I didn't like her. I felt that she contrasted herself way too much. There were things that she did that she took there were no moments of her being upset with herself in decisions she made near the end, or even trying to deal with those hard decisions. It felt like she was weak when she needed to be weak. It's almost like a coma. She was weak when she needed to be weak, and then she was strong when people needed to be invigorated to follow her charisma. And it felt very artificial to me. So I didn't like her probably 75% of the time.
I thought she was all right. I thought she was the reluctant leader that had to grow into one. And I disagree. I think her story was told well, because she made some very immature decisions because she wasn't a leader when she, in the beginning of the anime, her dad was. She had no idea what to do. but she felt that she needed to step up. And I think a lot of the decisions that she made by the writers was due to a huge part of lack of experience. And she grew as a character throughout the anime.
Yeah, I do see growth from her. And she's one of my big problems with a lot of these characters is they all are very the same. Koman almost has no growth through the whole thing, which is one of my big problems with him.
I agree.
Ayame, you see at least a little bit. You know, early in the anime, and we'll get to it. She turns the key over, and you know, so there's that self doubt, and then by the end, she's making decisions whether you agree with them or not. She's decided what's important to her, and she does stick to these convictions. Also, she has a steampunk bow.
That well, you know, confused the crap out of me.
Because anime!
I like the steampunk bow. That was cool. That was cool.
Which can... Wait, we have a weapon that can kill them, but we're giving these guys guns that can't?
Exactly. Yes.
Yeah. Because anime.
Yep.
While the train is leaving, Ikoma's infection gets found out, and he is kicked off the train, and the train starts leaving without him, and then they end up getting stuck, and Ikoma has to save the entire train, and has a great little speech about, you guys, I'm going to hell, you guys can all bite me, you have to remember that I saved your butts, and you're all awful people, and then... And then he gets saved and has to face all these people.
Well, wait a second, though, because I went back and I watched this scene because I remembered him saying it out loud. But I watched the scene, and you know what? The whole time, his mouth is closed like this. He's gritting his teeth. He's talking to himself. He's saying, yeah, watch, look, watch. He's not talking to them until the very end when he throws himself on the lever. That's the first time he actually opens his mouth to say any of the things that you hear. So I think that he was thinking that to motivate himself, and then at the end, you know, maybe yelling the last few words. Mm. But yeah, I had to go back and watch that before we recorded this.
I didn't get that. I just saw a guy cursing out the people who he assumed had murdered him.
Yep.
But also not very heroic that he just kind of was giving up. Like, you know, I'm going to throw this switch for you, and then I'm just going to lay here and wait for the end of days, whatever.
I'm just going to weep until someone eats me. Like,
see, I felt like that was his character, though. Like, that was the real him. The character that, you know, he's been a steamsmith all his life, not a hero. He's always wanted to be one, but he's never had to face being a hero and being not accepted. So, as a hero. So, this was something where, like, these people have shown him quite clearly they don't want him there, and he's still, it's a self-pitying moment. And I thought that fit his character better than most of the things he did later, I thought. But that's my perspective on his character.
I saw him as a character that was fearless. And it comes back to when he was infected. He gets infected and doesn't look at it like, oh, I'm about to die, I need to do something. He's like, yeah, I'm going to take care of that. You know, I got a plan B, whatever, yeah. I'm bit. Ah, you think that's going to stop me? He almost never felt overwhelmed or that he couldn't do it. That wasn't his character. So this felt out of place for me because up until that moment, we'd seen a guy who's like, oh, my entire village is burning. It's a great moment to test my gun.
Or before the outbreak. He's getting in front of loads of people with guns and standing up to the highest authority in the area, and he drops Kabane hearts on the ground, and instead of like, oh god, those aren't mine, who did that, he goes and picks them up.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. You're right, that particular moment where he's just completely given up, but is completely out of place. I mean, Takame throws him the chain. It nearly hits him in the head, and he just like, I'm not going to grab that.
I disagree. And the reason I disagree is because when that chain was thrown to him, I think he had reached a threshold. You know, you got to remember that he had been attacked the whole time by Kabane as he was walking down, making his way to that lever. You know, he was essentially presented as being at the end of his energy. So for him, this was, to me, the moment where they decided not to say, willpower, determination solves the day. The hero just finds that kernel within himself and succeeds. For me, this was the moment where they said, this is enough. This guy has tried everything. Everything you guys just mentioned all added up cumulatively to this point where I think this was his breaking point. And I thought that it was a really nice breaking point. I thought it gave him depth.
I like that.
Yeah, that's fair. Can you guys explain to me? I've watched this scene twice now when he's infected, and I understand the tying the thing to his leg, tying the thing to his neck. Why the hell did he bolt something to his shoulder?
He was trying to stop it at his shoulder. Instead of amputating his arm, it was moving too fast. So he's like, okay, I'm going to. If you notice, the metal on his body, progressively gets closer and closer to his neck.
Right, and I got that at the arm. I understood that at the arm.
At his arm. He can't stop it at his arm, so he tries the rivets in his shoulder to stop it from going past his shoulder. Doesn't stop his shoulder. So then he does the neck thing, hooks himself up to the machine, pulls the lever, and it starts strangling him. And if you notice, the virus actually reached out from underneath it, above it, but then stopped. So I don't... My theory is, I don't think the neck piece has anything to do with stopping the virus.
Oh, I think it's willpower.
I think it's a mixture of willpower, but also I think it's a mixture of, like World War Z, you've got certain people that either have an immunity or are resistant.
Well, they do say males are rare. Which, if this is something that can be replicated easily, you would think men and women could have this equally, the Kabaneri powers. But the scientist later does say a male Kabaneri is very rare.
Yeah.
And actually doesn't want Ikoma to die because, you know, we need to study him.
I like that theory. I like that theory a lot. The one thing I don't like about it is that it removes anything that acts as a governor on their Kabaneri state except will. But I do think that there is a little bit of a chink in it, which is the fact that the scientists that Bieber has have been doing experiments and creating Kabaneri, which we'll get into later. But those Kabaneri also have like ribbons and things like that, which Mume clearly says you have to pull this off for me to reach my full potential.
It's placebo.
So you think it's just placebo?
I 100% think it's placebo. Also, I think every other Kabaneri has been lab created.
Except him.
Except Ikoma. I think even Biba. Yeah. I think even Biba was lab created.
Spoilers!
Possible. It's possible. Yeah.
Guys, at the very end of the very last episode, you find out Biba. There is one more character we got to talk about before we go to the next episodes, and that is... God. The names in this anime. Kurusu.
Kurusu.
Samurai guy.
Blue samurai. He's cool. I like him.
He was bland.
See, bland? To me, he came off as one of the characters that had a... You know, he's known Kabane as something that he's had to defend his people against, right? So we see this situation where he's got to now get used to letting someone be stronger than him and better capable of defending the people he's always defended. He's almost having to step down as a bushi, one of their samurai defenders, and letting this enemy stand up and defend this girl that he so obviously loves. He was interesting to me for that reason. Plus, he wound up blushing at the end for Ayame instead of the girl blushing. I thought that was cool.
Remind me, which one of you liked this anime? I'm having a hard time telling.
Like I said, the first 5, 6, 7 episodes, go ahead if you have a good imagination. These are gold for me. These are the gold part of the series.
So this samurai guy, I found him very bland, at least in the start. And, you know, I felt that it was he was very cliche. And I was like, okay, I know where they're going with him, but he needs that redemption moment, right? Because he's obviously, he's the one who shoots Ikoma off the train and leaves him to die. And so we're giving him that he has this very hard worldview. He's very, almost a villain in the beginning of this because he's Black trying to kill our main character. And so, you know, there has to be this redemption moment for him. And it barely comes at the end. But yeah. His redeeming quality is what Jeremy mentioned of the fact that he is hopelessly in love with Ayame. And that a character that with that personality type, with that hardness, has that very weak spot, very soft spot inside him, did endear him to me a little bit. It wasn't until that moment that I started to like him. So Mume trains Ikoma to be her shield. She's like, hey, I found another one like me, and you're going to be my whipping boy. Jeremy, this is like your favorite scene here, right?
Yeah, this is my favorite scene because Mume's manner of training is the most amazing thing I've ever seen. She just basically kicks you while you lay on the floor. And then when you stand up, she says, and you're asking her, like, how, you're not teaching me anything. How do I do this? She says, oh, you just spin around and boom, bam, boom. he puts it so succinctly. You're a terrible teacher. I was like, this is great. She's so casual about this. It's just, I'm going to beat you up and you're going to learn. That's it. That's all there is to it. I thought that was really
And yet
fun.
He becomes the best fighter of all time. No matter who he fights, he's like, oh, you're awful. I'm great at this.
Yeah.
Like, actually, I like his lines because he's like, oh, Mume's much faster.
He spent an afternoon just kicked by her and is suddenly like, no, I can handle anything.
Yeah. Yep. Yep. Yep, there's a Kabane coming up in this little arc that we're talking about where this happens. Yeah, just drives me nuts.
So the train has to stop because the water tank is busted, and it kind of gives the survivors their little reprieve. At the same time, so two things happen at the same time, and that is Ayame and Ikoma's scene together where she proves to the people that he is harmless. And then once they're in private, he attacks her. At the same time, Mume senses a Kabane among the survivors, and it's a pregnant woman who was infected, and then she has to kill her in front of everyone. It's a little frustrating, because the reason Ikoma attacks is because they need blood to survive. That is what the Kabaneri need. And you'd think that would have been mentioned in the getting kicked and trained at any point.
But no, because then it wouldn't have had that dramatic value that it had at the end of episode 3, where you're like, did he or did he not turn? You just don't know as the viewer. If they'd said it, you would have known. I think they wanted that dramatic effect.
Well, but she's hungry herself and goes out to the village people and is like, hey, can I have some blood?
Yeah, which one of you is it going to be?
You know, it's at this point that I wasn't connecting with these characters at all. I was like, who are these people? Even Mume, who I end up liking, the characters I do end up liking, at this point, everyone felt bland to me. I don't know about you guys. Jeremy, it sounds like you were connecting at least a little bit more.
I was connecting with the characters because there was enough mystery left that I was trying to still figure out who they were, and that let me connect. When I later saw who they were, I started to disconnect more. Hmm. But at this point, they were still being established, and so I liked them.
For me, at this point, I actually really liked Ikoma. I liked that he was figuring out his new place in the hatred of people as a Kabaneri. I was getting to know Mume. I really was rooting for Takume, Ikoma's best friend.
Fatty.
Yeah. Because no matter what happened to Ikoma, he stuck with him because he was his best friend.
I didn't feel they built that enough. He kind of just showed up. Hey, friend, let's go. And they're like, oh, that's his best friend. And they didn't have a whole lot of heartfelt moments until a very important moment, right?
That was established in the very beginning when
they worked together, right?
Yeah, not only did they work together, but like Takume showed that he absolutely cared for Ikoma's well-being. So,
but Ikoma seemed to not care about him. Was more my point. I never got that the other side mattered. It felt like a very one-sided friendship.
Yeah, I'd agree with that.
This is where I think that the first four episodes should have had at least one more, or even two more episodes. I wanted to know what was the situation like for Ayame's father when he took his men and they tried to take the train. You know, I wanted to see what happened there.
Because after he leaves, the next time we see him, he's a zombie.
He's a zombie. He's a Kabane. So I also wanted to see like more of the town struggling to slowly defend, but it felt like the Kabane just overwhelmed them way too fast. I mean, these guys, they have defenses set up. I know the train barreled in and everything, but I would have liked to have seen that. And then the same thing with episodes 3 to 4, there was room for a little more exploration of the characters.
Disappointed with was, you know, later on you finally get this moment where there's this solidarity, and they're like, you know, okay, I'll give up my blood, and oh, I'll give up my blood, because you know these two Kabaneri are defending us and they love us, and you know, we want to be their friends. I felt that could have come a lot sooner. I don't think the awkwardness of Mume going, hey, I need blood, and then people like going, I don't think it needed to be that big of a deal.
Yeah, so when Ikoma tries to bite Ayame, this has a huge fallout for the entire train, right? Because the Bushi, the samurai on the train, want to kill them. The nobles no longer trust Ayame's judgment, and they actually take the key away from her. That's what I mentioned earlier, that she actually has to give up her master control key. And then they decide to take a more dangerous, quicker route to the shogun's city that they're heading to for safety, which ends up in a huge attack. Not only do they get attacked, we see what Jeremy had alluded to, that these Kabane can learn, and we get a super Kabane with swords, right? He's big and he can fight and he kicks everybody's butt, and all the Kabaneri have been locked away in the back of the train and have to fight their way up to the front. And then that's when they are accepted because they win the fight, right? And like, okay, you can have our blood. Thank you for saving us from this evil
again sword guy.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. See, and this was exactly what I meant, where you mentioned him becoming the strongest fighter in the series, right? And Mume says, this Wazakane or whatever he's called, basically a Kabane that's learned to wield a weapon, learned to fight.
He's a Wazatori.
Wazatori, thank you. Yeah, this Wazatori is a formidable foe, she says. And now this is Mume talking, right? Mm. And so then she collapses because she's so tired. So I'm expecting like this really cool fight scene where he's going to be challenged and he's going to, you know, really have to put everything he's got into defeating this thing. And no, he just drops in behind it and, you know, kicks its feet out from under it and says, you're not as fast as Mume. And then poof, hits it with his captive bolt pistol, his cow slayer gun. I'm just like, come on, man. It's this easy for you.
I don't think it was that easy. Crazy. That was lazy writing. The episode was coming to an end. They were focused a lot on Kudusu, so they needed to wrap it up.
That's exactly what I thought. It was all time.
Mm-hmm. They also locked away anyone who was nice to the Kabaneri into the back, which was odd.
That was just
like you're slightly accepting of them, and so you must be. And they think they're monsters at this point. So you just decided to kill these two people. These are our heroes. These are the characters we're rooting for.
Yep.
Kabaneri lover.
It was rough. We do get to see that Achilles heel. Like you said, Mume falls asleep. When things are at their worst, she's like, hey, I'm out. I'm going to lay down here on the roof of this train and fall asleep. That was a really cool thing about her character. Yeah. She's the best fighter on this whole train. She has a time limit. And it kind of reminded me of Evangelion, how they're like, we have these super awesome robots. If they unplug, you have like 15 seconds left before you're dead.
She's All Might.
That's awesome. Yes, you're right. Yes.
there's a scene in this, in the last episode, episode 4, where a guy has to use a suicide bomb. So in this anime, if you're infected, you have to take a bomb, you place it to your chest, and you pull the string. It takes out a whole frickin' wall in this episode.
He did it on purpose.
Taking out the wall?
Yeah, yeah. So if you watch that scene again, he was trying to take out a large portion of the Kabane army that was marching in that car. So he put himself up against the explosives to set them off.
Was there explosives behind him?
Yes. Well, something that would explode out if hit by his charge.
In episode 1, Mume's bodyguard or traveling companion also uses a suicide bomb, and his coat didn't even flap behind him. He literally just pulls it and falls over. Right. And then this one blows out a wall, and I was like, how? And they use these bombs a lot, but it was a little, and I'm not the guy.
Extremely inconsistent.
They were inconsistent.
Yeah, that's a symptom that goes across all spectrums in this series. But there was something else too. I think that a reason they did that was entirely for being able to link up the two parties. You needed to be able to have that same sense of place so that you knew that Karusu and the zombie with two swords, they were fighting and you could see the tunnels go by. You know, you'd see the light in the dark and light in the dark. And then you'd get the same thing when you got the perspective of Ikoma traveling across the top of the train. You got that light and dark, light and dark. I think they were just doing it to sync the scenes up. And so whatever the situational result of that would have been was just to get that scene to look right for them. That's what I think was the whole reason they did that.
That makes sense. That's actually pretty cool, at least from an artistic standpoint, right?
Mm-hmm. I thought it was a nice touch, but I didn't catch the explosives, and I thought, holy crap, a whole wall.
So we the train gets to the first station on their trip, and it's Yoshiro Station. This station, just like their home, has been overrun, but there are survivors still inside. And the survivors whisper of the Black Cloud, which becomes a very big focus of these next two episodes. But the best part about this episode is I felt like this is where Mume got her character development. It starts here, and she became an interesting character here for me. Because she runs into, his name is Inoku. He is an old man who's a cripple, and they work for the same person. So Mume's trying to get to someone, right? And that's why she's going with these survivors on this train. And he kind of tells her, like, you know, quit being nice. Quit playing nice. And I had even written in my notes before this happened, like, Mume feels so distant from everyone. It's like she refuses to get close. It's like she refuses to play nice, and yet he's still, yelling to her, quit being this happy person. Like, you're a weapon. You're a warrior. And he mentions the young master. Mume has a huge character change at this point. She becomes rude to everyone. She becomes arrogant. And they have to come up with a plan to get past the station, which has wreckage. Ikoma is now apparently planning things. but she's like, no, I don't need your plan. I'm just going to go in and I'm going to kill all the things. That's what I do.
Yes. I thought Mume was actually hunting something in the boiler room. That's what I thought she was so intent on getting in there for. But as the scene developed, I realized, no, that's not what it is. It's just that she sees herself as this tool that is designed for nothing other than destroying Kabane. And so if she doesn't function as a proper tool, she's going to get killed just like she's a useless tool. Not that she's going to get killed. It's not fear of death. It's just the fear of being useless for what she is supposed to be, being weak. And there's a scene where she remembers that there's another, it's someone on the field. It looks to me like they're in the same battle raiment as her. So they're probably another Kabaneri. And her brother orders that Kabaneri to die because the Kabaneri is too weak to get up and move on their own. And so that, I think, was what this whole scene was trying to develop, is this sense of, I am failing in what I'm supposed to be doing. I'm failing. I don't deserve to live. I'm going to charge in and prove it.
She's trying to establish her worth. Mm-hmm. You know, like, she has, this is the only way I have worth.
But her worth is 100% tied to her brother's words of, the weak deserve to die and the strong deserve to live. And so her the way she shows her strength is by being this weapon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Of course, that goes horribly wrong. She, you know, she kills a bunch of the zombies, but she actually wakes up a whole nest of them, right? A whole horde that was hiding down below, which sends the entire mission into a tizzy. She actually gets thrown down, and Ikoma makes the choice to save her rather than to finish clearing the wreckage for the train. And they get pinned inside of a cave, and the black smoke awakens.
Okay, hang on one second.
Tell me about the black smoke, guys.
Okay, the black smoke is really, really awesome. It's the craziest creature that I've seen in this series and in a lot of other series. I loved how it just piled the bodies together to make itself, but I thought that what you mentioned previously about there being a psionic aspect to these Kabane had to be present, because you watch this thing and then other black smoke creatures you see later, they have completely different abilities when it comes to battering through terrain. There's one later that completely brings its arm down and just devastates and smashes a really, really big wall. This one punches an area where a big blast door is shut, and it just, you know, destabilizes. And they say a big enough impact will destabilize it and stuff. So I thought that it was a great idea. It was really interesting. It was crazy, but it was so inconsistent that it just bugged me. But there was something I wanted to mention. When she fell down there and he jumped down to rescue her, she fell down there because she was fighting another Wazatori, just like the one with the swords, only this one was a brawler. And this is the second Wazatori we see, and it's dispatched in exactly the same way. He drops down behind it. Its expression changes to one of startlement. He puts his cow killer to its chest and just blows it, and it's dead. And I'm just like, I realize we're dealing with a time constraint here and you have to hurry up and move, but it's a Wazatori. I want to see a fight. I want to see this thing be as difficult as it was for her. I know she was tired, but come on.
So the Black Cloud is a mass of Kabane that move as one big monster, right? Jason, what did you think of it?
I thought it was interesting. I was actually really disappointed when I first saw it. First thing that came to my mind was World War Z, all the zombies working together to get up over the wall, right? But then it showed that it had a single heart unit that was in control, and that totally threw it for a spin for me. And I thought it was a really neat monster.
I loved it because I didn't see it coming. I could not have guessed that a creature like this was going to show up in this anime. I thought we were going for pure zombies, and zombies have rules. You know, zombies are mass, they're hordes. Giant zombies rarely show up. That's like a Resident Evil thing. That is not.
Right.
I didn't see. So yeah, it caught me by surprise. And you guys know I love that. It also leads to the best moment in this anime, because the train has to hide, and then they kind of sneak out while it's not ready. They go and they save Ikoma, they save Mume, and they get a cannon, right? And then this thing comes after them, and we get a big train versus giant monster battle. But this is my favorite moment in anime.
Evasive maneuver. When I heard her yell, taking evasive maneuvers as she's driving a train, I'm like, what? What evasive maneuvers? Oh, she pulls a lever and changes tracks. That's the evasive maneuvers on a train.
Screw you, Jeremy, because she didn't just go faster. She took off her coveralls down to her tank top because she was serious. And I love that.
Oh my God. That character was a gun show the whole series. The pink haired train conductor, she was nothing but a gun show.
As soon as she's like, you want to go faster? I need to lose some clothes. I was like,
yes.
You're great. This anime should be about you.
Yep.
But I really like this sequence because everyone has a purpose for the first time in this series. You know, Ayame is the captain. Fatty is firing the cannon. The American guy actually gets some dialogue here.
America-kun. He's awesome. That is my favorite character.
The samurai and Ikoma have to defend the cannon from the stray Kabane that are falling on the train. And Mume has to kill the heart. And they're going so fast that they go around a corner and they tilt and everyone's got to jump to the side of the train. This was really, I had a lot of fun. I had a big smile on my face during this whole sequence.
It was action packed.
Yeah.
This was when I was like, oh, I see what we're doing now. I get this show for the first time.
There was a particular quote that I loved in this scene. It was where Kurusu is standing there holding this new sword that Ikoma made for him that is coated in the same thing as the hearts of the Kabaneri. Or the Kabane, sorry. And Kurusu is unsure about the sword. And so he's looking at Ikoma. And Ikoma says, yeah, if you die, don't blame the sword. Like, that's great banter. I loved that. They did really good with banter throughout a lot of this episode. Great writing.
Yeah, it's like the characters didn't have good character moments on their own, but their dialogue every once in a while just hit really nice peaks. Mm-hmm.
There was another scene where Ikoma and his friend, they were walking to that control room as she was going to the boiler room. And the expression that they gave his friend, Takoru or whatever his name was, Fatty, right?
Takami.
Yeah. His expression is so great. His eyes are bulging. He's got on this massive fake smile and he's just got sweat pouring down and he's just walking. They're like, are you all right? And he's like, yeah, I'm great. I'm fine, man. That was another great scene. Also, one other point is, keep in mind that the zombies climbed up the wall here. They were not part of the black smoke. They were just individual zombies, and they were climbing a sheer wall surface. Because this doesn't happen at any other time, even though there are sheer wall surfaces they could climb.
So these black cloud monsters become very important now in this anime. Do you think this one came from the same ones, the same place the other ones did?
No.
Yes. I do.
Oh!
I do.
The reason I don't think so is this one didn't have the purpose that the other ones did. And then also Mume obviously would be knowledgeable about these things, but she did say that, you know, they've shown up in other places.
Yeah.
She didn't. It's unclear whether she knows how they're made at this point or not, because near the end, when she sees how it was made, it shocks her. So,
well, she's shocked when she kills the heart. So she actually jumps into the black cloud right to the heart face to face and shoots it. She's shocked for a moment by what she sees.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that could be recognition, or do you think just like, or maybe we just recognize it's a Kabaneri.
Look at the outfit. It looks like it's wearing this. It looks like the girl is wearing the same outfit she is. Plus, where's the black blood? We know that that is a required constituent part. It has to be injected into the heart of a Kabaneri to make these creatures.
To make the ones that were being controlled later,
right?
Because in order to give them commands and to have it, that it needed to be that blood that was developed by those scientists. Like, but I said, this one didn't seem to have any direction.
And like Jason said, they do point out that she knows of them. They do exist in nature, right?
But you did say earlier, Jason, that you believe that Ikoma is the only natural Kabaneri.
Right.
Which means all the others would have had to have been created, right?
Well, we don't know.
Which means they would have had to have come from these people.
I mean, we don't know for sure black clouds need Kabaneris.
That was my point. I don't think the heart was a Kabaneri. I think it was just a Kabane that developed into the heart.
Oh, if you go back and watch it, it's wearing the same outfit she is. That's part of their claw outfit. That can't be coincidence.
I'll have to watch that scene again.
Guys, this is the kind of stuff we're never going to agree on. So if you have an opinion on it, we would love to hear you. You get the final say.
Hey.
You listening.
Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm remembering it wrong and she's not wearing that outfit. But I remember that when I watched that, I was like, is she a clone? Because that looks just like her. It's wearing the same outfit and everything. What the heck is going on?
But Tanya, I know you're listening. Tell Jeremy he's wrong. So then they arrive at Shitori Station. Shitori Station is fine. Everything. This is our quiet
slice
before the storm. And then our slice of life episode.
Slice of life episode. I know, I thought the same thing.
I was waiting for a beach scene or a shower scene for sure.
Yeah.
And we kind of got the shower scene, huh? Because everyone goes bathing and doing laundry. But I thought there'd be a bathhouse scene. I was like, yeah, we're going to get our bathhouse scene. Here we go.
Yep.
No fan service.
But basically, everyone goes shopping. And Ayame goes to meet the leader of the village and do some trading with him. Really just a take a breath. We just had an intense action. We're about to go into the final push of these episodes. This is our calm. The episode does end with Ikoma and Mume having a conversation where she tells him about how she was turned into a Kabaneri by choice, that it was not natural like his, and he promises he's going to turn her back into a human, kill every Kabane, and get the rice fields growing again so she can fill her belly with rice. Which becomes a big thing. I didn't even write it down, but it became such a big thing later on that rice became her major focus in life.
Rice.
Yes. We make fun of it a little bit, but you got to remember that's been a staple. No. Rice has been a staple within Japan for thousands of years.
I was actually surprised when they said that. I was like, oh, really? Because I would thought they would find a way to keep getting the rice.
I think the point of using rice is the mundaneness of it. Because it shows that such a mundane thing has been taken from everybody. And that's why this holiday of hanging their wishes on the trees was so important to everybody, because normal life has been stripped from everybody. And the idea of rice paddy fields growing and people being able to harvest it and get back to a normal life is such a pipe dream for these people that's why it became important.
Yeah, I think you're right. Plus, you know, obviously her name meant we'll be like filling our belly with rice or something like that. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure that was to do exactly what you said. It's a good emotional connection with the characters and the world. I like that.
So at the end of that episode and going into the next one, we meet our main antagonist, Mume's big brother. I'm using the quotation marks. We meet Biba. This is my favorite character, and I am in the minority. reaching out online, people didn't like this character at all. I want to give a speech. I want to pour out my heart for this poor man.
Do you want to lead with that, or do you want to end with that? Do you want to find out Jeremy and I's?
No, I want to lead with why. Like, and then you guys, because I actually didn't see why people didn't like him. Compared to the other characters, he's not a great character. I'm not crazy. Well, I felt compared to the other characters, he's at least ahead on the bell curve. So let me make my speech and you guys can tell me why I'm wrong. And at least, because I want to understand what I missed. And I know I'm wrong. But this character, not only did I enjoy his character, he redeemed Ikoma a little bit because, like I said, they're very much opposites of each other. Ikoma is loud and passionate and expressive, but fearless. Biba is calm, collected, deliberate, and terrified. At first I was like, oh, I picked on something subtle, and then it was not subtle.
Oh, you found a coward.
he is a man who is terrified of everything around him, and that is his motivations for the horrible things he does. It's not a great motivation, but it's at least a unique motivation. I don't know if I've seen it before. And he tells a story in that about his father, when he's with his father and the lights go out and his father pulls out a blade and just starts slashing and he gets all cut up and then the lights come back on and his father tells him, oh, that wasn't me. That was the fear. And then we find out later, Biba was sent at 12 years old to lead an army to take back Japan from the Kabane and then was cut off by his father with supplies and left out there to die. And I see everything he does in this anime as a person with the lights out who's slashing around in fear. he is still that 12. He has the body of a man. He is still that 12-year-old boy who is lashing out, terrified of everything around him. And I found that so unique for a villain that I was really drawn to it. So now you guys tell me, what the hell is wrong with this guy?
To me, Bieber is nothing more than... Sorry, that's just how I think of him. He is nothing more than a sociopathic, genocidal maniac with some serious dad problems. I like your presentation of him. I do. I like that presentation a lot, where he is this guy that's scared, attacking in the dark. But I think that at the end of the, I think it's like episode 11 or something, he's standing there watching the destruction around him, and he says, what should I destroy next? He's cold and calculated even in his choice of what he's going to destroy. So in that case, to me, it doesn't seem like he's, you know, lashing out blindly. A terrified person is often also called irrational. And for him to be so incredibly precise and calculating and succeed in all of his machinations means that it can't be terror that is solely guiding him, or it can't even be the strongest point.
Yeah, I see no logic connecting the decision making and the source.
Yeah, and then in addition, we know that he is a confirmed liar. This is established pretty clearly because he's been lying to Mume all her life that she's been with him. He's been lying to a lot of other people. He lies to get whatever he wants done so that he can kill people, get into good situations to do that, right? So how much can we actually believe this story that he tells about being a 12-year-old commander of 400,000 men? If we look at history, the youngest commanders of military forces are around the age of 17. And that's Alexander the Great, 16 when he was, you know, when he became king, 17 when he did his first campaign. I looked for any other young, even like feudal Japan or any other type of young, known military commanders. The
God,
only
you are such
types.
A nerd.
I am. I know. I can't help it. This stuff drives me nuts. The only ones were young because they were kings. And so their presence on the battlefield was nothing more than to instill morale in the troops. They were not strategists. They were not tacticians. They were not telling the men what to do or setting up positions. So I look at his story of, I was a 12-year-old and I was leading 400,000 men and we established outposts and we were getting supplies. We were winning. And my father just cut us off. I think he sent him out there with a token force to die. And then this kid managed to, with whatever charisma he had, indoctrinate this token force and keep building from there, taking in whoever was strong enough with this 10-year-long Bieber's vengeance that he has to come back and enact. And I think it was very petty. His motivation is very petty. So I love the character that you present. And like I said before, this is about where, for me, I would stop watching. I would recommend people to stop watching.
Would you say this is where the anime goes off the rails? Thank you. I'm here all night.
Yes. This is exactly where it does that. Yes. And I think it can be identified down to, in my opinion, the hunters. If they'd gone a different direction with them, it'd be good. So
I want to hear from Jason about Mr. Bieber.
I don't have a lot to say about him because I do love the picture that you drew, Troy. Unfortunately, his actions betray the story he tries to tell, and also what other people are telling about him, specifically with the terror and fear. If he's so terrified and afraid, why does he have a car full of Kabane? To me, I saw him and I saw his performance even all the way until the end as a discount recycled Sephiroth.
Ooh, that's good. A pink-haired Sephiroth.
That is remarkably accurate.
That's really good.
Sephiroth without mommy issues. Daddy issues instead.
Daddy issues instead. Yeah. Dead over.
Okay, let's keep going. So yeah, we also meet, Jeremy mentioned, he has his hunters. This is a group of Kabaneri fighters, and they have motorcycles. the episode after that, Calm Before the Storm, has a big, it's really just about, hey, well, there's Kabaneri outside. Everyone panics, which is weird because it seems like that's always the case. But they take their train outside these hunters, and they just wipe out all the Kabaneri in this field. And we see how good they are at fighting. We see their cool motorcycles in this
jump of the shark. Oh.
I was quite upset about the motorcycles, I'll be honest.
You know, the only thing that upset me more than the motorcycles was the way that Bieber mounted his horse. That got me so out of the blue. This horse comes galloping by the front of the train, and he just leaps off the front of the train, lands on the horse, and keeps going, and then motorcycles join him, and I'm like, what am I watching? What the hell is this? That was so terrible.
So after this battle, Biba convinces Ayame, hey, let's just link our trains up. We're going to the same place. And then sends Mume to go get her key. She's giving a fake one by the driver who helps out Ayame. And then, so that builds this tension. Like, okay, they don't trust us. We can't control them yet. You know, the survivors are like, hey, these guys, they want to take our train. That's weird. And they're like, oh, I guess they're not going to let us do whatever we want. I guess things are going to get ugly. And this episode ends with Ikoma and Mume arguing outside on the train because he can sense there's Kabane on the hunter's train. And we get that shot of it, right? That huge cage. And we're inside the cage and they're on the outside of the cage. They're like built into the train. I don't really know how that room worked, but...
There was two other things I wanted to mention here very quickly. One is the assassin, which you mentioned him before. He was the guy that was, you know, previously a part of Bieber's troop, the hunters. And specifically, he claims to be, I think it was like a hero or something like that. So somebody that was high up. So he would know what's going on and what Bieber's plans are, right? And yet we are supposed to believe that Bieber sent this guy on his way. As callously as Bieber kills people, he sent this guy on his way because he didn't want him to be part of his retinue anymore, but didn't kill him. He kills Hidori later, you know, for nothing because he's scared. But he doesn't kill this guy, even though this guy knows what his goals are or what he's been doing, at least. And I think that the character was actually wasted the way that he was killed by Bieber. There was a lot more potential in what could have happened with this guy than to just be executed on the field like that. That was a little sore point for me. I wanted to see more coming from, you know, intrigue within the hunters.
Yeah, I'll be honest. I hardly understood what was going on in that scene. This guy's like, I'm here to assassinate you, but I'm seriously loyal to you. And he's like, no, you're not. You are actually going to kill me. Okay, who is he on your team or not? I don't know what's happening right now.
Yep.
But all that scene is to show the ideology differences between Biba and Ikoma, right? I'm willing to kill this guy, and Ikoma's like, no, we gotta save all the people.
And then also, so Ikoma could later say, I watched his face. You guys didn't see his face. He smiled as he killed the guy.
Smiled, you're right.
Ethical differences there.
So... So this kind of starts the push into the end of this story. They go on to the last town before the Shogun's town, and this station is the gateway to the capital, right? Biba and Ayame end up meeting the leader of the station at the same time, and he sends Mume on a little errand. Ikoma's trying to get Mume back for everybody, and she, because see what they asked him to. And she opens up this station for the hunters to get in because she's told, hey, these guys are being jerks. They won't let us in to the safety of their walls for, you know, because my dad's a jerk. So she opens up the station doors and they let in all the Kabane. They actually draw them in with blood streams, right? And
on motorbikes.
On the motorcycles. They kill everyone, and yet still, Biba infects his girlfriend, right-hand girl, this
Hidori.
This other Kabaneri with him, and turns her into the Black Cloud Monster for the purpose of destroying the gate so the train can keep going through. Mm-hmm. And this is where we learn this is his doomsday weapon, right? Is he can create the black clouds at will as long as he has a Kabaneri to transform.
And black blood.
really interesting what happened after the black cloud dissipates. So the Kabaneri, that her name is Hirobi, she, after calling Biba out for being a coward and always being terrified, she only is able to hold the black cloud form for so long and then transform into like a super Kabaneri who is shooting energy blast and has a blade arm.
That was cool. That was cool. Choreographically.
It was cool. It was very cool.
I thought it was an interesting story point, too.
The energy caught me off guard in a steampunk world, but we already have motorcycles, so why should we hold on to any kind of genre conventions?
Maybe it was purple steam. I don't know.
I think it's psychic energy. Back to what I said earlier. Multiple characters get this power, and yeah, it seems to be brain-induced.
See, this was a... To me, I actually thought this was a really fascinating moment because of the way Hirobi is doing her catapulting, going around killing everybody, and then she jumps over to Bieber, and she stops with her arm blade right, like almost touching his forehead, and they really zoom in on the bead of sweat, and then they build his face around the bead of sweat, showing how scared he is.
Right, a really beautiful shot, because when it first went off, I'm like, oh, she's crying. That makes sense, because you just see the drop of water go down. You think it's her tear. Then I thought, oh, it's on Biba, it's his tear. And then it was off to the side, and I'll be honest, I hadn't really figured out the whole he's a scared of everything thing.
You think it's a tear?
No, I thought it was a
tear. Sweat.
No, it is sweat. I thought it was a tear. So my first thought, her tear. Second thought, his tear. Third thought, oh, they're just showing him sweating. Why are they doing that? And that's when I thought, I think I'm picking up on something here. And then they literally just kept saying it out loud. Guys, I felt clever.
He was scared. Yeah. Well, I thought the thing that really affected me in this scene is that his sword is not drawn when she stops with her hand in front of his face, with her blade touching his
sweet gun blade.
Yeah, his gun blade is not drawn. But then you see her, like, her jerk, and she's got a smile on her face, and her eyes are open and everything. Like, she's coherent. She stopped. She didn't kill him. This person loved him. You could tell. Mm. And so then you see her jerk and then it shows that he stabbed her. He had no reason to stab her except his fear, because she was obviously in control or he'd already be dead. So that whole scene showed you just how much of a sociopath he is, that he's such a jerk. Nobody matters.
Partly. She showed that she had very little control. She had some, especially when it came to someone that she cared about. But she could not tell the difference between enemy or foe once she dissipated. And the first thing I thought of when I saw her was, oh my gosh, she's got a Guyver suit.
Yes.
I thought Witchblade. I was like, oh, yeah, she's a Witchblade.
Totally. Yeah. I would agree there too.
Yeah.
So all our main characters, all the survivors that started this off, are captured by these hunters now. Kurusu tries to save Ayami because she's off, you know, with the main people, and he fails, and him and a scientist carrying a case fall into dust, cloud, steam. You can't see them. They're gone.
Obviously not gone. Words. No, not
clearly possibly. Falling to their death, or you know, for sure, in the worst plot twist ever.
Yes.
They capture Ikoma, and we see them kill a child, you know, just to prove that hey, these aren't good guys,
right? Because the child is infected.
So everyone's captured, taken onto the hunter's train, where they are bled for food for the Kabaneri.
Wait, was it Kabaneri or for Kabane? Because I was under the impression it was for the Kabane.
Do the Kabane starve?
I don't know.
So I think that whole room of caged Kabane up in the front with the blue heart was a laboratory for creating the white and black blood. But they needed human blood on a large scale to
convert.
To do any of the converting.
Tanya and I were staring at that thing and we're going, what the hell is that? Where did he get that? How did he make it? What is that? But it does make sense if it's a black and white blood generator. that could work.
So Ikoma manages to lead the characters in a escape, and they push their way up to the front, and we find out that Bobby was Miba.
Bobby. I know, I'm making it worse, but I can't.
No, stop, and at this point, I actually was writing down the wrong name, and it wasn't like two episodes later I realized it. I'm sorry. So I was reading off my note. Biba had planned for this, and he had asked Mume, okay, you need to go kill these guys. I'm sorry, I know they're your friends, but they, you know, they're being jerks now. They're trying to escape our prison. Yep. And she's like, no, I want to be with them. This is when she makes her character decision of who she wants to be, which felt a little late to me. Yes. She's seen some horrible things up to this point from this character, and she's still super loyal to him, even to the point where she's coming to talk to him about the fact that, hey, you know how you're bleeding my friends?
Yeah. Correct me if I'm wrong, but this is the first time we see her since she said at the preceding episode, at the end of the preceding episode, he's a liar. He's been lying to me all this time. He's a liar. Ooh, boom. Earth-shattering moment. I don't think we see her again until she comes in here after we see the entire bloodletting situation. It's like, what is she doing that whole time that she's not aware of what these guys are going through?
So she gets captured and they brainwash her to fight. Biba kills Ikoma's buddy. Well, he tries to kill, he shoots at Ikoma, and his fat buddy jumps in the way and takes the shot and dies.
This scene did not make sense to me, because if you shoot a Kabaneri anywhere but the head, they will regenerate. Like, unless you break their heart cage, they're going to regenerate. So there was literally zero reason for Takame to take that bullet.
I totally agree. Did you have anything further you wanted to say about it? Because I got something.
I wanted to interrupt his review of the episode, because that particular as much as I love the rest of this anime, that particular scene bugged me, and I understood they were looking for some sort of next drama loss moment. That didn't need to be it.
I totally agree. There was, I think they could have done the scene better. In all honesty, even if they hadn't changed the fact that he was going to die there, I think that they could have presented it. You know, there was that scene where they were sitting together. Ikomo's in his cage. His best friend's sitting next to the cage. They're having a buddy moment. They had a few of these. It was nice.
In actually, buddy moment, let me read you my notes, because I wrote these notes. They're written together, but they were written at separate times.
Okay.
Oh, we're finally seeing some friend bonding. Oh, that's why. Because they were going to kill him.
You know what I wrote? You know what my notes say? What the hell, blonde guy? What the hell? Because that stupid mustached blonde guy who's just beating the crap out of Mume, beating the crap out of Ikoma and everything. And that was this particular episode. And shortly, it was at the scene where she gets overtaken, right? But they could have in that moment where they're having buddy bonding, where he's like, you know, that when you got shot before and pushed out of the train, I wish I'd jumped in front of you. But instead, they wait until he's shot, and he's like laying there shot, and he's like, oh, I wish I jumped in front of you, and I'm so glad I did now. And he still doesn't die if after that.
Yeah. So Ikoma gets his arms cut off, and then he's attacked by Mume, where she stabs him, we're led to believe, through the heart, and he's dropped from the train.
No.
Okay. Go ahead.
No.
No, the blue spurt that happens to every single Kabane or Kabaneri death did not happen. And when he fell, it was instantly, to me, it was instantly apparent that she missed him on purpose.
Yeah. I saw that too.
Just call me dumb. All right.
For me, the issue was that it was predictable. There's no way they'd kill Ikoma off. I wish that they had, but there's no way.
Yeah, I knew he was alive. I'm not that dumb.
But another thing I take issue with is the fact that they blew his hand off. Like you said, Jason, the Kabaneri are capable of regenerating as long as they don't die. So him losing his hand, I mean, he freaking says that he got his stomach. A Kabane took a bite out of his stomach when he's down there underneath the train tracks with Mume. right? And he regenerated an organ. We know that they bite through tendons and muscles, and he regenerates those. So why not bone?
The hand had to go. The hand had to go so we could have the awesome Evil Dead moment.
I called that the moment he lost his hand. As he's recoiling a bloody stump, I'm like, he's putting his gun on there.
I thought the same thing, but I was like, I hope they don't put his gun on it. And here he is riveting it to his arms.
Strongly disagree. I loved it. I was like, yes, get that kid a shotgun. Let's go. Let's go.
This is my boomstick.
Yeah, exactly. I thought this is something that would be really cool if I didn't have all the other issues compiled on top of it. But they are. And so for me, like, especially when he shaves his hair off, as you'll get into, that just putting the gun on there, I'm like, well, this is like the moment previously where he defeats the train, he protects everybody, and they show a glamour shot of a baby smiling. And you're like, what the hell is this? Why is this here? Why are you doing these glamour shots? You're trying to like tell me this is so cool. Look how cool this is. Oh.
So let's push into the ending. A couple things happen. Biba injects Mume with the black cloud, turning her into a black cloud, which takes her a lot longer than it seems it took the other characters. But he basically injects her and releases her into the city because they get to hit the Shogun city. And he uses Ayame to present him as a prisoner to his own father. And at which point he then infects his father so that his father will be killed by his own men. And then decides to just destroy the whole city, which was kind of weird. You know, like you guys were saying, the logic of his decision-making doesn't make a lot of sense. You know, you could have just taken the throne. You could have just stopped right here, you know, but that's not what he wants.
Weak people. He doesn't want weak people serving him.
I thought the coup was super good. I liked the writing of that whole scene of him on his knees, gets his dad to take the knife, and turns him. And up until the point where he gets on the loudspeaker and starts creating mass panic, before that, I enjoyed that entire scene.
Yeah.
And poor Ayame trying to calm it down, just trying to install and get rid of that fear, and that fear just taking over everything.
Yeah. I liked where he, after his father was like being shot and everything, he said, "It wasn't me that killed you, it was the fear," or something like that. Basically going back to what his father said to him. I thought that was good. That was really good writing. I agree with you. I liked that, the way that was set up. My biggest issue, other than what Bieber did, was Ayame not having a moment. This is what I meant, where she didn't have a moment where we got to see that she had conflicted emotions about being involved, because she had to know her part in this, that he was going to kill his dad. She knew that that's what was going to happen.
Well, I didn't think she did.
We don't know how much else there was. I got the impression she did. That she knew his plans involved doing what he did in the previous town.
Jason, I mean, you want to give me a minority report on this?
I think she didn't have much of a choice, and I think she was playing along to protect her own. I don't think she was emotionally involved or felt responsible for anyone within the walls of the Shogun City.
See, and to me, if that's the case, and that's what seemed to be depicted, I really don't like that character, because she's not taking responsibility for her role in this. I imagine people could look at it as, no matter what she did, her people were going to die, right? Or if she fought him at all, her people were going to die, so she might as well do what he says. But I think that it either means that she is a sociopath, if she doesn't have a moment of dealing with the conflict where we get to see it. She's presented like one, if she can just shrug off the deaths of so many people for the sake of her own.
I think it's the problem with the setup you're looking for is, and this is the one issue that I had throughout the entire series, and we've touched on it a couple of times. Every episode, not every episode, but most episodes felt rushed. And it's because they were doing action pack after action pack, because they were presenting this zombie apocalypse. So the issue that of the moment you're looking for, there's no time for it.
Exactly.
Not just because of the writing, but because of what's going on in the story. Like she physically doesn't have a moment to stop, because she's going from, I'm helping him to, okay, now everyone's dying. What do I do next? I got to get out of here. I got to get on the train. We got to get the train out of here. And by the time they have a moment to breathe, the episode's over.
But I also think that's all presentation, though, because they get to choose how they compile that. They could insert it.
I do think it's also Ayame's character arc, though, is that she has decided what's important to her. She's decided what she's fighting for, and that's her people. She's going to get them to survive. That's more important to her than the Shogun's people, than this capital city. She has decided what's worth living and dying for, and it's a little sociopathic, right? But it's one I can relate to a little bit. Like, look, if the world's going to hell and everyone's going to die, this is the thing that I'm going to protect no matter what.
That's also a very monarchic lord way of thinking from her position, especially in that feudal Japan shogun era, where the lords wouldn't necessarily give two craps about the people in another city or in another district or another land, even if it meant lives. It, like you said, her responsibility and what she decided was important was her village, her people, the people that she decided that those were the ones she was going to save, and that other people would be responsible for saving that whoever else.
What about her uncle and his family and his children that are her blood relatives that she was so happy to see?
She made her choices. And this journey has made her choices. Now,
I wanted to see her make that choice. Like, you made the choice. Like, you described it. You're like, oh, I can see making that choice because I'd have to decide for my people, I will let it go. We never got that with her. We never got a moment to see her
It did kind of happen off camera, and it seemed like, okay, I'm fine with this.
Seemed like it didn't happen.
End of her story arc, I'm going to skip a little ahead just for her. When they get away and they're getting about to run away, the hunters show up and are like, can we go with you? And she's like, yeah, that's cool.
We got to help them. She has another one of her massive monologues.
That was a little rough. Didn't you guys just get done torturing us and bleeding us? And yeah, we got room. Get on.
I did think that it was kind of cool to see the development of the blue-haired character, because when you first see him, you're first introduced to him, he's a total ass to Ikoma, right? He uses his knife and he stabs it into a spider on the wall, right? Frightening them up for no reason. But then you see him when they're bleeding the people out and he's like, dude, why you gotta be such a jerk to the weak, to another guy who like chops someone's hand off? And then you see him now and he's the only survivor that are of that group. And he's like, can we just join you?
That character is the only reason I believe they're going to do a season two, because that character was too cool and too like, this is a cool character, guys, to not build up. And they didn't. He had those two scenes you mentioned, and that's it. So I feel like if they are going to do a sequel, he's going to be a much bigger deal. We need to keep going. Elsewhere, Ikoma runs into Kurusu and that scientist. He's feeling horrible because his friend died and worthless, blah, 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 blah. Hero journey. What are you going to do? Kurusu, you know, he tells him, you know, we got to go save Mume. She's been injected, and gives him that buck up speech. We find out, okay, there's the black blood and the white blood, right? If you have the black blood, you become the black cloud. If you have the white blood, that can cure Mume and get her out of the giant monster and save her.
So that's turns her back into a Kabaneri, though. It doesn't cure her to a human.
Not human, right. That's when we get the Evil Dead scene and the worst haircut scene I've ever seen in my life. Guys, I've never been so pissed off at a haircut ever. Because I'll tell you, Ikoma's bangs through the entire anime bug me. And I was letting it go because it's anime, whatever, crazy hairstyles. But he's cutting his hair. I'm like, I like this. He's like, okay, I need two eyes. He cut every piece of hair on his head except for the ones in front of his face. There was no point for the haircut. All right, that's my rant. I couldn't handle it. He transforms into a super Kabaneri. Because males can't become black clouds. I had that right? That's why he's like, yeah, if you inject it, you're just going to become super awesome. No,
you do. You have
turn
that
into
right.
a monster. What yes. a what a shortcoming.
Yeah, they actually have a term for it. The females turn into news, N-U-E, and the males, they don't. They just turn into awesome Kabaneri.
But they will, also lose their minds.
Yeah, he'll turn into a full-blown
Kabaneri. This is one of the things that I think works towards your theory, Jason, because when he takes off his collar, I believe the scientist says something like you'll only be able to keep your mind for a few seconds, but he retains it for a very, very long time. Now, I don't know if that's will or if that's because he's the only one that's ever become a Kabaneri the way he did.
I was actually just about to mention that. That's funny. Sorry. That you said that. No, that's fine. It's interesting that you made that connection as well. Black blood and the white blood are specifically designed for their lab-created Kabaneri. And obviously, the effects were different with Takome because he wasn't lab-created. And again...
You said Takome.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, Takome's dead. Ikoma. And also, we see at the end, he doesn't lose it.
We have to come back to that when we get there.
Yeah,
there's so much crap revolving around this moment.
That's why I say Guyver.
Let's blow through this final episode because basically it's just a big battle episode. Ikoma now has psychic energy powers. And Kurusu just blow through the city.
Favorite scene ever. Him putting his hand out and the train doing a flip above him, like superheroes when they do, they hit a car and the car flips above him, but an entire train. How awesome is that?
That was pretty cool. This is a Kira moment, right?
Yeah.
That was really cool, but what spoiled it for me was that the blonde mustache guy walks out from the smoke. He was on that train. He was standing on the front of the train, and he just walks out of the smoke, and he's like, "Well, I'll stop you." And I saw exactly.
He was a Kabaneri.
How did he get off the train?
I thought they were going to tell us he was a Kabaneri, and he wasn't.
Mm-mm. He's just a dude. He's a dude that can take out Kabaneri
and just move it like that.
Yes, I hated that guy so bad. Oh.
Basically, Ikoma and Biba have their big battle. And Biba starts to win because Ikoma starts going crazy, right? His time's up.
Actually, first Biba starts to win, and then Ikoma gets mad and starts to win back. Because Biba actually
typical
gets
anime
an arm
battle.
Lock. Yeah, but think about it for a second. Ikoma just stopped a train with his psionic power. Biba is just a regular Kabaneri. Just spoilers, we know he is. So we know his power level. His power level is not stop a train. Right. How is he able to grab Ikoma and twist his arm up and restrain him? The kind of force he'd have to use would need to be equal. It just, to me, that fight was ridiculous.
But Ikoma didn't stop the train with his arm. He stopped it with his mind. Or his energy power.
Where's that power now?
But he used it. He threw Biba away from him when he got pinned. That's how he broke the hold. He actually used his mind power again. And through him,
it was new. He didn't know how to use it.
It was coming out very sporadically. It was definitely not something he had any control of.
It's like a superhero that just gets his powers. They're awesome, but he has no idea how to summon them.
See, for me, it felt very formulaic. Like they were showing you, oh look, he's not winning. Now he is winning. Now he's not winning. Now he is winning. Now he's not.
Yeah, it's an anime fight. I mean, you could predict it from beginning to end. He goes crazy, and Mume drops his special stone, which is his reminder of his little sister that he's carried this whole anime. It lands in the water, and it wakes him up. And he manages to win the fight. He cures Mume, and then he goes to lay off on the ground and die. Biba gets up as a Kabaneri. Biba wakes up as a Kabaneri, wants to keep the fight going, and tries attacking him, and Mume kills him herself. And he says, Mume, you know, why? And she's like, that's not my name. I like rice.
Exactly. I'm going to have rice patties.
So I mean, that's the end of her character moment. She finally gets to make that choice of, I don't want anything to do with you. You've been evil for half an anime. And I finally realized it.
Yeah, exactly.
One point I want to bring out. We never actually see Biba die in the Kabane way or Kabaneri.
Kabaneri. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
You're true. Yeah, I could very much see him being, if there was a second season, because they would need a villain at least of equal stature. I would definitely see them bringing him back as a first choice.
Yeah.
Yeah. I do have to wonder, though, if, I mean, in order for that to be the case, Mume would have had to deliberately miss again because she stabs him presumably through the heart, but I didn't see a blue smoke. Did nope. you?
That's why yeah. I say I don't think he died.
So then did she miss on purpose or is she just so woozy that she missed? Is that what we're thinking?
Yeah, I'm thinking it was a mistake. I think she thought she killed him.
Hmm. See, this is where there's a lot of weird stuff going on because when
right
when
now.
Ikoma,
let's just say it. So they grab Ikoma, they run back to the train, and they're like, "Oh, Ikoma's gonna die!" And then suddenly he's healed, and yeah. Mume says, "Big bro must have saved him. He injected him because they did show Biba had a vial of white blood himself. They gave it to yes. him, and that
we never see him use it though."
I watched this scene twice. I went back and watched this fight. Like, where does he inject him? Couldn't find it.
I found
it's
it. Very,
did you? Was it when I he did. Shot him?
Yes. Because there's a distinct green mist that comes out of her when Ikoma uses it on her. And that same green mist comes out of his heart area when Ikoma or when Bieber shoots him while he's laying on the ground.
So he wanted the fight to keep happening, so he shot him to cure him and keep the fight going.
So that I think he could defeat him. I don't think he thought he could defeat him with one arm unless he disabled him, brought him back to Kabaneri. That's the only conclusion I can draw.
Huh.
It's the weirdest thing, but that green smoke is there, that green mist.
See, so I saw that scene too, and that's what I suspected was the moment, but that... You do see that metal ricochet too. So I assume whatever hit him hit his metal plating and skipped off. But
it's really weird.
It's very weird. And then I even wrote a curse word in my notes because I was very upset.
There is another thing here. That stone has been a major part of this show that's just been sitting in the background. And I wanted more explanation about it because I think it's a fragment of the heart, the blue heart. If you look at it in the beginning of the series, it's green. And it's always tied to his palm, right?
When she they showed it up, where the stone came from.
It was just a river stone.
Right. They picked up two. They each took one.
But right. earlier in the anime, Mume mentions how much it hurts
That's
when
right.
he hits her with the hand that has the stone in it.
Exactly. And when you look at when she's about to drop it, it's blue. It's not green anymore. It's blue, and it looks just like the stone. Even by the time it hits the water all the way down, it still looks like the glowing blue stones that make up the heart that she's in.
So it's just some random Kabaneri heart fragment they found?
That's I
guess
what it is.
When you first started saying that, I thought you were saying it's the sister's heart. I'm like, well, I could at least see like her spirits in it and why it's helping. Just some random Kabaneri spirit.
I think it's a random Kabaneri heart. Yep. That's the only thing I could conclude from that because, you know, why That's else silly. Would it have any effect on the Kabane at all unless it had something to do with them?
I can see your point, and you're probably right, and it's still silly.
I agree.
yep, I do too. But they kept it, and so it has to be important.
Okay, guys, we got to wrap up. Jason, give us on a scale of 1 to 5 the Bakas, and what did you think of this anime?
I loved it. It obviously had some flaws that we've talked about. And some of the characters, I have a hate-love relationship, so I have a solid 3 Bakas.
Wait, you loved it and it only gets 3?
That's some love, man.
I would give it 3.5. I was going to say 3.5, and I was like,
we're Sith. We deal with absolutes here. Right.
You got to move it up to a 4.
Yeah, move it up to a 4, man.
All right, I'd give it 4. I would definitely watch it again, and if they come out with a second season, I'm watching it.
Can't believe you caved like that. So,
That shows how Jeremy, much he loves it.
Jeremy, hit us with your review.
I will say that Mume was a really interesting character because it felt like she was caught between a psychopath and a dominating character who said, I will drag her out if she won't come out. So that was hysterical to me. There were a lot of moments like that where there's these weird situations and the characters have a lot of potential, but I think that potential was not realized at all. I think that it started out having all these layers and then it slowly peeled them away bit by answering the questions and giving you answers you didn't want to hear or diverting you from what was interesting to you. Like, why did the Kabane learn? Where would that go? And so I got to give it a 2. 2 Bakas.
It had a lot of high highs. It had some really low lows. Episode 6 alone almost made this whole anime worth watching. For me, well, I love that train scene. I love so much. I can't express enough. I'll probably like a year from now be like, I'm gonna go on YouTube and just watch that train fight. I enjoyed it so much. Even the blonde guy who they thought was a traitor for a moment, who always hung out with the driver chick, having to go under the train to pull a body part out so they can go full speed. Every character got important in that scene, but. Until that moment, I had a really hard time connecting with this, and I enjoyed the late latter half because I thought the villain was complex, and he brought a complexity to the main character. Because I complained about Akoma being fearless in the beginning, right? But it made sense when there was a coward of a villain, right? Like, oh, that's why they had him not care he got bit. That's why he was not afraid of anything. I'm only giving it 3 Bakas, though. And I will not change it for anyone. Okay, so that's it for Kabaneri of the Iron Fortress. I hope you guys enjoyed watching it, or at least enjoyed talking about it and thinking about it. I hope you enjoyed this episode. Next 2 weeks, we are starting our first double episode. So what that means is the anime we're going to watch is 25 episodes long. We're going to watch the first half for the next 2 weeks, and then the second half the 2 weeks afterwards. So part one, and the anime is picked by Jeremy, ReZero, Starting Life in Another World. You probably know about this. It's a very popular anime about a boy who travels to a magical land, and every time he dies, he has to redo that day or that time frame. Jeremy, you picked that. Anything you're really looking forward to on it?
I really enjoy anime that have to do with time loops. I also really enjoy stories that have to do with going into some kind of different world or VR environment or something like that. So this has a lot of potential in my books. But honestly, the reason I noticed it in the first place is I was going through anime lists for this particular season. And I went, oh, this one's got a high score and it's pretty. What's it about?
I've been wanting to watch it forever because it's so popular. We are only watching the first 13 episodes 1 through 13 for the next 2 weeks. You guys can watch as fast as you want, but this is a hard rule, and I'm telling you now, do not go past episode 13 until after the podcast. that way when we complain about stuff, we're all on equal footing about not knowing what's ahead.
Fair enough.
And then if you want to contact us, and I really hope you do, we really would like to hear from you guys. Contact us on Twitter at Baka Podcast. Tumblr is the same. Our email is theanimebakaclub@gmail.com. If you're watching this on YouTube, feel free to leave a comment. We are on YouTube. You just search for Baka Baka Baka. We'll show up. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Anything else you guys can think of?
Yeah. Let us know how wrong Jeremy was.
Absolutely. I'd love to hear it.
Awesome, guys. Guys, thank you so much for showing up tonight. Thank you for watching this with me. Say goodbye.
See you later.
Never stop watching anime.
Sayonara.